Welcome, everybody. We're going to call this meeting in order at about 6:05. And the first part of our meeting is going to be a public hearing on our proposed FY18 budget. And I think probably the best way to start that is maybe to have a brief overview synopsis of the budget from superintendent or business manager, and then maybe open it up to questions from the public, if there are any. And we'll have a little back and forth, and then we'll have some discussion, and then we'll move on. So, superintendent.
Thank you. Thank you, and thank you all for being here tonight. I'm really pleased to see you all. And I really would like to encourage you to come to the town meeting March 7th.
That's no, the annual town meeting.
The annual April. The annual town meeting in April. Please come and show your support there. That would be wonderful. Thank you so much. Can everyone hear me? Great. I'm just going to make a short statement. I'm going to let Patty walk you through all the details, but I'm going to make a short statement to help you understand where we're coming from and the school choice, the thing we're doing with school choice and how we have to start making adjustments for that. Thank you.
What do we do to kids when their phone rings?
Dance. Our overall request, budget request to the town is $119,628 over this current year's budget. Our salary and staff cost increase is 2.94% or $131,297. We were able to offset this increase by a net decrease of $11,669 in operational costs to arrive at the requested increase of $119,628. But what I'd really like to emphasize tonight is that we have been too reliant on school choice funds to provide necessary services to our students. And although our revenue, to our students, and the revenue is declining, but our student population is not, and their needs are not. So actually, our school choice funds are declining because we stopped accepting them in the lower grades, but our numbers are still 402, and the needs of the students coming in have increased dramatically. So this reliance on school choice is going to be difficult. To get to this position, we have tried to make some reductions. Understanding, and we have understood this, any reduction hurts and causes change. But we were very mindful when making these propositions or these proposals to the school committee, and we really truly believe that these very small changes and reductions will have the least impact on our students in the classroom. In 2016, we had 93 school choice students. This year, we have 75 school choice. The revenue for school choice funding is flat, $5,000 per student, while the cost of funding our school and our native population, as well as school choice, that funding is continuing to increase. Not funding, the cost of funding our school are continuing to increase. My predecessor warned us that this was coming. To quote her, "We have been depleting our school choice reserve by using the funds to reduce the bottom line of school budgets in an effort to make them more palatable. This is not a practice we can continue." And this budget is developed with that in mind. We cannot sustain our school programs with school choice funds. Therefore, we took the time and the energy to find the least impactful, the least of the changes we could possibly make so that we could reduce some of that school choice reliance this year, so that next year it'll also be a minor in decrease. We are looking at over $200,000 of loss in revenue next year if we don't look at something this year. I'm trying to be forward looking. We're trying to maintain the same level of education that we have that makes Deerfield the quality school it is. This is where we are. I appreciate you listening, and I'm going to turn it over to Patty so that she can walk you through the details. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Carey. There are copies of the budget in this box if anybody needs one, and if that's empty, there's a couple more up here if anybody would like one. So I'm going to start on page one, which is our superintendent's budget message, and I'm not going to read that to you. You can all read that at your leisure. And then pages two through six is the narrative that I'm going to walk through. So if we start on page 7 of 26, this is our student and staff data sheet. This is a new sheet to our budget package that was brought to us from Dr. Carey, and this is very useful information. So on the left, we're looking at our number of students. And the top box is our current enrollment as reported to the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education as of October 1st. And then we're doing our projected enrollments for 2018. The 2017, I'm not adjusting to actual because we have to leave it at the October 1st. But down below, our projected enrollment is as the current enrollment is in Deerfield Elementary today. And as you can see, our kindergarten class already has 50 children enrolled. That is more than we expected. We've had all kinds of enrollment projections done, and everyone says that our enrollment is supposed to be decreasing. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts got less Title I funding and Title II A because we were losing children in Massachusetts, but yet they're still coming to our kindergartens. So we haven't seen that decrease in students yet. On the right-hand side, we're showing the makeup of our staff and how many positions we have and the changes from last budget year to this budget year. And below that, we list out what our teachers' credentials are, how many teachers are at each level of education according to their collective bargaining agreement. So this is a quick snapshot of our student and staff. And above that are the goals from the principal's school improvement plan that this budget supports. These are her and her school committee, school improvement committee. These are their goals, and this budget supports those goals. So if you go to page 8, this is our sheet to show us where we are and where we're going. So we have a collective bargaining agreement negotiated increase for this for fiscal year 18 of 2.5%, and that added $63,555 to our budget. We have teachers and IAs, 48 or 46 of them, still stepping, and that added $40,942 to the budget. Degree changes. In the last contract, there was a new column added, Masters plus 45 or CAGs. Here in Deerfield, we had 5 teachers that were eligible for this column move, and then we have one other degree change for the total of $15,497. The lead teacher stipend was increased, so that adds $1,500, and we have 2 new people joining the longevity schedule that would add $500. We're putting in an allowance in here for non-union contracts of $7,652. We are reflecting that our school adjustment counselor, I know it says guidance, I was supposed to correct that to school adjustment counselor, I apologize. We was at a 0.8 FTE and now it's 1.0, so that would require $12,793. We are adding a library instructional assistant position of $15,293. And we're changing the music teacher funding. This was previously funded on school choice. We're moving it to the town for $28,616. We're also reducing the reading tutor position, saving $26,811. Our retirement buybacks, we are saving $11,142 versus the retirement buybacks we had in 17 versus 18. We're reducing the library media specialists by from 1.0 to 0.8, which would save us $9,906. And we're reducing a total of 0.6 FTE speech and language pathologists, but only 0.1 of that salary is a reduction to the town appropriation of $7,192. And that is where we get the $131,297 increase for salary and staff related costs. Some other things that are changing on the operational side is the central office expenses increasing $36,191. Deerfield's percentage is increasing slightly from 28.72 to 28.86. But the bulk of the increase is due to our loss of grant funding for two positions. Our elementary curriculum director salary was partially funded by Title I. And each year, we've been receiving less and less funds. The other funding was the state-funded grant for kindergarten, the kindergarten grant. That was reduced last year, eliminated for 18. That caused an increase of $10,834 and $13,400, the two-year accumulated shortfall of $24,234 for our early childhood director. The other thing causing this to go up is our health, dental, and life insurances are increasing in the aggregate about 10.4% for health and 8% for dental. And at the regional, the employer bears 80% of that increase. And we did have some savings by closing 219 Christian Lane, and so there was decreases for electricity, telephone, internet, trash pickup, building heat, and building repairs. And the full effect should happen in FY19. We used very conservative estimates in reducing these costs because we don't know what it costs. We have no history to know what it costs to heat an empty building. So we're gonna use, this winter is, we'll adjust to whatever we spent this winter. The next increase we have was instructional equipment, $6,752. This is for a new copier in the teacher's room. We currently own the copier that is in there. We've had it for about 4 or 5 years. It's at its end of its useful life. So this is the cost of a new lease for a copier. Network and telecommunications, $5,094. In our IT director's first year, he spent his focus on inventorying our hardware. That was last year. This year, he spent it focusing on what are all the softwares that all the buildings use. So there are adjustments in all our software accounts. So some are going up and some are going down. But it's a combination of having a correct inventory, knowing what the licenses we need to pay for, and changing the allocable base of those based on the type that they are. For instance, some get appropriated by the central office allocation. Others are charged by the number of teachers in the building. Others still yet are charged by the number of devices that we have in the building. So the IT director and I spent a lot of time identifying the type and how, what was the best allocable base for those. Building maintenance, we're looking for a $3,000 increase. Principal's office expense. And
can I just interrupt for a second?
Yep.
Just in the, you're doing a wonderful job. If there's no objection, I mean, people can see the budget. Given the amounts that are in the next six items, maybe we just, and it's going to be a long night. Is anyone object to just boom, boom, boom to the...
Sure.
I mean,
I don't.
You can see what they are. They're $1,500 here and there. Okay. So, sorry to interrupt, but just, I think it's going to be a long night. So,
okay.
Or it might not be. So if you just want to go to the decreases where there's a bigger impact.
Okay. So some of the decreases, we have an out-of-district tuition. We have a child going from 6th grade to 7th grade. Our testing and assessment, our SPED director has done a reevaluation of our 6th graders again moving on to the 7th grade, and we can decrease that line item by $19,285. Decrease in non-employee insurance, $10,175. This was adjusted based on what the town is charging us for our building and our liability, school committee liability insurance. Again, the offset to the increase, the instructional software, and transportation is decreasing $6,544. And that is because the current COLA adjustment clause for each successive year, FY18, it is going up 1.06, but it's offset by the fuel adjustment clause savings that we've been experiencing. When we initially had the contract, the pinpoint was like $3.04, and on average, it's been about $2.04. So for every live mile times the savings, we get a credit on our transportation bills. And then the psychologist supplies were just decreasing 300. We're adjusting to what we've actually been spending. So our net decreases are 70,656, which brings us to a net change of 119,628, or 2.68%. The next pages are just the detail of that summary, and that goes from page 9 to page 16. And then starting on page 17, we're looking at all our funding sources. Our town appropriation, our school choice, our revolving accounts, and our grants, Title I and SPED. And if you go to page 24 of 26 on the bottom, the total amount to be expended by Deerfield Elementary is $5,472,960. 83.85% of that is what we're requesting from the town. The next page after that is our school choice analysis. As Dr. Carey said, this is where we're focusing our revenue. If you look at the revenue in our actual revenue projection for this year is $647,624. But the projected revenue for next year is $453,752. And that is a reduction of $193,872. And it's a difference between having 93 school choice students in FY16 and 75 reported so far in FY17. So as Dr. Carey had mentioned, we made some reductions to address this. And we've reduced the computer teacher from a 1 FTE to a 0.8. The library media specialist has also been reduced. It's the elimination of the reading tutor position, a 0.6 speech language pathologist, and then adding a part-time library assistant to ensure that the library is still open 5 days a week for student use with the reduction of the library media specialist. Those reductions total $85,167. So what we are proposing to spend from our school choice fund is $498,546, which is a decrease of $56,320 from the previous year. And our last page, 26, is just the computation of the allocations. For the four elementaries, Frontier assessments, and the superintendent office cost percentage split.
Okay, thank you for that summary. If you don't mind, I'm just going to ask a couple of clarifying questions.
Sure.
Before I open it up, sorry. Back where we just were on the school choice, and I'm sorry, you probably answered this in the last meeting or maybe before, but the projected revenue in school choice funds, we're looking at a roughly $200,000 reduction, and yet you just mentioned something about roughly 20 students, which usually is around 5,000 ahead, which would be 100,000. So what's the nut in there that makes that such a big number?
Okay, so where the difference falls in is it's $5,000 per student unless they receive special education services, and then we get a special education increment for those students.
So we've had some students who are graduating from the school who are receiving that much higher level of school choice?
What happens is the timing. So when they do our projection for the 18 revenue, they are basing it on what we reported to them on October 1st. So they, anyone that was in sixth grade and was getting a sped increment is wrong. But we don't know yet if any of our new school choice children will be getting that sped increment until we get to June. So that's where the balancing comes out, because we don't report the sped services till our final report in June. So they're looking at this as 75 kids, no sped increments, except the ones that you had existing. And then we'll, when we report in June with our new figures, and it includes transportation, so if we are transporting any children, if they require special education transportation, we always we get that refunded. Wow. So that's where the, why it's not, you know, apples to apples.
And then just another thing, when we went through the reductions in costs back on page 8, and you mentioned a decrease in retirement buybacks. Do we know, is there some kind of policy or rule, I'm not sure if it's under our bargaining agreement, or tell us at a certain date or not? So in other words, is there, is that fixed, or can somebody, I assume people have, people do whatever they want, so if someone wants to retire, they can still do that,
correct,
and we don't know about that.
Correct.
Okay.
So the amount that's reflected here is fixed because the date has passed.
Oh, so there is a date that you have.
There is a date. Oh, okay. According to the collective bargaining agreement, if you want to get paid when you leave in June, you have to tell us the previous year.
Okay.
So the money's here is not someone, is for someone who left last June that we were unaware of. So that, we did not know in June that they were going to retire. They did not return in September,
right.
So now their funds are owed, but they're not going to get paid until school year 18.
Okay. Right, either way, we're spending less money next year than we did this year. That's
correct.
Why the reduction. And that number is firm because there is some obligation to let us know.
Right.
Okay. And then on the increase in central office expenses, I understand the $36,000 and you went through the... is it safe to say that number didn't involve any new hires, or doesn't involve any new hires, but it was just the, you listed all the people I wasn't always paying attention to.
Correct. No, those weren't new hires, but now that you say that, there is one additional position that was put on at the end of June before Dr. Carey arrived, and it was in concert with us getting PowerSchool, changing our student information system from Rediger to PowerSchool. Our IT director recommended, we had someone who did the reporting for the high, for the regional, and someone that did the reporting for the elementary. In order to get consistency in reporting, they wanted that to be one position that reported for all five schools. So that position was added to the budget in central office, but it reduced a half-time person at Frontier.
But that position was done last year, so that we've already done that this year in this fiscal year's budget.
No, because it was done in June after the budget was done. So it doesn't really hit us till FY18.
But we've been paying that person.
Yes.
Okay.
So we have to adjust our budget to accommodate that.
Okay.
And then there were two other salaries that were
right.
Because of grants.
Grants were not there.
Yeah.
Any other?
My notes to reflect that higher position.
Any other? No, I was just wondering. Any other members have any sort of broader comments or questions before I open it up?
I have just one point of clarification, if you could make it, Patty. I believe what we're asking for, or what we're discussing, I should say, this evening, is a 2.68% increase in the request for raise and appropriate from the town. But the overall budget, I believe, after all funding sources are accounted for, is less than 2.5%. I think when we discussed it at the last meeting,
what would be the choice funds we're going to get?
Let me just pull up this year's budget and I will
2.04%.
Okay.
The note I had in February. I'm just trying to be clear. That's what I had noted. That's where I'm picking it up.
No, the 2.04 was if we took all the if when we were proposing the reductions.
Okay.
So let me just get you that. That's a different figure, and I can get you that.
No, I'm just.
I can tell you.
Right. We had made a conscious choice, but I wanted to know. We have a total. We're going to confuse the audience here. We have a total proposed for discussion in terms of the town meeting floor of $4,562,35. But the full school budget, after all funding sources are accounted for, including school choice, is $5,472,960. I'd like to know what that increase is over current fiscal year.
Less than one. Our overall increase is less than 1%.
I just meant 5,472.
960, and last year our total budget was 5,426,220.
All right, any questions from the public? You're always first. Anyone else? No? Okay.
Patty, would you go back over the school choice figures? 93 and 75 are the ones I wrote down. Are those correct?
Yes.
So 75 is this year,
which, yes.
What we have, and 93 was FY16.
Correct. But not, just to be clear, we saw we had 96 kids. They didn't all stay for a full year. They could have come later or left early. FTE was like 93 point something.
Yeah.
But there was 96
close
children.
Yeah, close enough. And that was due primarily to the reduction in, I don't know whether it's kindergarten or first grade at the time.
So going our sixth grade left, and there was, I'd have to pull up last year's enrollment. So sixth grade left, and kindergarten that came in is much less, a smaller number.
Okay, but we went from three classes to two classes.
Yes.
A couple years ago.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
2 years ago. Since we've started with the school choice and not accepting as many to fill mm-hmm. that third section, only 1 year were we able
yep.
to sustain two classrooms for our native population. That was the first year. This year, we had to have three sections mm-hmm. of kindergarten, and next year, with 50 already enrolled, there'll be three sections of kindergarten, okay. And those are our native population students.
With 50 enrolled, do you anticipate adding school choice to that?
I think the goal was no, because as you got up into higher grades, if you were ever to be able to drop that back to two classes, you could do it. But if you had school choice in there, you were stuck. You had too many kids to be able to drop it to two classes. So the goal would be in the future, as they get up into 4, 5, or 6, right?
You'd have to lose approximately 20% of your 50 students to drop it back anyway. So I'm not
right.
Probably. Well, we'd have bigger class sizes, is what the school committee was discussing, that maybe at fifth grade or sixth grade, two classes of 25 is manageable, where 25 kindergarteners and two is just not feasible.
It would leave us that choice, but
the profile of students are receiving, it just
that of the special needs students, how many of those are either pulled out of the classroom or out of district placement to start?
We have, besides, I don't consider them out of district placements because we have them in specialized programs in,
okay.
In our other town schools.
Yep.
Currently, in all four elementaries, there is no one out of district.
Okay.
We have built the capacity within our elementary school specialized programs to keep our students in our schools.
Okay. What I was wondering is, you have the breakdown of special ed students. Of that 75, approximately, and I realize you're not going to be 100%, but approximately how many of those students are in the pull-out programs?
Do you know how many of our native deer
give or take
are in the LEAD program?
Four at least. Four at LEAD.
Four.
Yeah.
So
okay.
Four.
Okay.
Are in a substantially separate program.
Right. Right. Yes.
That's what you're.
That's what I'm.
And I do believe we have two others over in Sunderland.
One of them is tuition of our four leads. One is tuition.
Correct.
Two or
two. From
another district. Three. Three. So two of our students are in
the. No, out of the. Okay, so out of the four in the LEAP substantially separate program, three are tuitioned in.
Okay.
One is a Deerfield student.
But we have two Deerfield students attending a program in Sunderland. Three. Okay. So each elementary school has a different program specializing in the different needs.
Yep. This is a request from us from the classroom teachers. And so next year we know that kindergarten class that's moving up to first grade, there's going to be three classrooms, and so there's currently two. How are we planning to be able to have that third classroom for the first graders? The incoming, is it just moving teachers around that
yes,
are currently
that's in already been determined and discussed with teachers? Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Sorry.
That's okay. I was just curious about your heads. When grants end, we have some grants that have ended. How is that, what are those grants and how are they looked at to decide which of those grants, do they just kind of automatically get folded into the budget, or do you look at each of those positions to decide, do we cover that cost? You know what I mean? If that sort of a money that you're getting from somewhere else, is it an automatic that the town or the school budget has to take that in?
So, can I just clarify? Okay. I assume you're talking about the district-wide positions that are grant funded?
I don't really know. I just
okay.
heard you say that.
So,
yeah, so what are those positions that, because there are some grants that ended, and it sounds like we're sort of absorbing that money, and how that's
so,
decided.
Sure, so whoever, we could probably start with historical knowledge if you have it about
yes.
those positions.
So the current administration, myself and Dr. Carey and Mrs. Barrett prior to Dr. Carey, have a very different philosophy about what should be grant funded versus what should be appropriated to the towns. When you have positions that are, you know, that are basically required, like our curriculum director. And in this climate with our early elementary, those positions should have probably never been put on grant funding. Because regardless if those grants go away, we still need those positions. So that is what we inherited with these people. So now as the grants have reduced, we have been trying to make the transition every year a little bit easier. But then the carpet sort of got pulled out from under us because we were gradually moving piece by piece the salaries back over. And then the governor reduced significantly the kindergarten grant and then eliminated it this year. So we had no choice but to take the large hit this year. In that same vein, as I had previously said, that all indicators are is that there's less children in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So our federal entitlement grants have been decreasing. And because our school does not have a high poverty we're second on the list, because the entitlement grants basically go to the high poverty schools in Massachusetts first, and then we're the second layer. So only a partial piece of that. So it makes sense now to make the switch, and then what'll happen is we use the Title I to fund our reading recovery teachers in the elementary, and if we have to make a shift because we lose 3,000 here or there, that's much more easily found in the budget. And I would have to come to the principal and say, we got $2,000 less than we expected. How can we make cuts somewhere else to make up that $2,000? So that is how we're approaching our grant utilization now. It's much different than it had been in previous years.
So was there a curriculum, who was the curriculum person? Not who, sorry, which position? We had a bunch of curriculum pieces.
The elementary curriculum part of that salary was paid for Title I funds.
The whole salary?
A part of that salary.
Part. Okay, so that maybe.
Right. And when they brought, it's my understanding that when they brought on an early childhood director, it was 100% grant funded.
At the beginning of that position being
correct.
Hired. Okay. And at the position of the elementary curriculum, was that person at one point just on sort of our budget and then some of it was paid by a grant, or did that person also come fully on a grant and now we've been weaning?
We allocated a piece of that salary because the elementary curriculum director is also the grant director for Title I. She writes the grant. So they assumed that we should take a piece of her salary and allocate it to the grant. But regardless if we get the grant or we don't, we still have this position.
Yeah, okay.
So just to reiterate, the entitlement grants that we relied on, that funding from the federal and then the state is dropping. So the kindergarten grant that we relied on for our early childhood coordinator, my first week on the job, it just disappeared. It just disappeared like that, and it was July. And you know, we're scrambling how we're going to pay this. The other thing is we have a preschool grant, and that is phasing out over the years. The first hit is taken this year, we're losing $6,000 in the preschool grant, while we are all recognizing that preschool is where the action is right now. We need to get these students in here. We need to be working with these students. We need to help prepare them to be ready to learn when they hit kindergarten and move on. So we're in a really tough situation where our grant funding is decreasing. School choice is flat. No matter who we take, we get $5,000. If there's special ed, we do get an allowance at the end, an allocation at the end. But that's flat. Meanwhile, the costs are going up. The needs of the children are going up. And so we're in this kind of paradox where, well, you can understand. But the grants, yes, and that was quite a hit to the, it looks like central office, you know, is gone, you know, but it's really absorbing what the grants have stopped paying for.
Anyone else? Yeah.
Can you clarify the computer teaching for next year? It says some places reduced and not in other places.
But this for the elementary school?
Yeah.
It's being reduced 80%.
So which is 4 days
a week.
One day.
Yes.
The students will still have access to their computer classes. The students.
The lab would still be open. The teachers could bring classes down. Yes.
Right.
Sign up.
Do you want to? It sounds like you were saying you saw something in two different places. Is that what you're trying to get clarified?
Page, is it not on page 8? It's not on page 8.
Because it's funded by school choice, and the page 8 is summarizing the town appropriation, what we call our general fund appropriation, the change, the differences. So that's why it is not reflected there. We have to keep our buckets of money separated.
I didn't see any line item for an OPEB contribution, and you know, we were trying to encourage that.
This is news to me that each department is supposed to fund their own OPEB.
Well, Frontier Front does make a contribution, and we talked about it last year when we were looking over the budgets, that it was really important that at least a token amount of money was put in the line in the next year's budget.
Okay. But I assumed that that would come from the town to tell us how much the OPEB obligation should be, because this is the town budget. This is coming from the town budget.
We have not agreed. We have not agreed on an amount, and you know, it's about $2 million, and about 2/3 of it is school related, elementary school related. So, but the town itself, the municipal part, cannot pay for that. Its own share, and so we're discussion back and forth as to what amounts we should put forth, and so we had talked about last year a token amount and start the line item contribution somewhere. So
I guess I'm confused, Carolyn, because this is the same money. You're saying the town, but this is the 4.5. If you're asking us to add an OPEB line, it would come from the town anyway.
I realize that, but it still has to be a line item here at some point. It will be mandatory. There will be a mandatory contribution at some point. So it's better to put a line item in and put some token amount, whether it's 20,000 or 25,000 or 50,000, whatever. But there should be a line item because about 2/3 of the obligation is school related.
All right. Well, it sounds like that's a sort of a discussion for some time in the future. No, I mean, it doesn't sound like there's sort of a meeting of the minds yet on how that's being handled, so I don't know that it's...
Well, it would just be helpful if you put in a line item and then some, like I said, token contribution, because that's what we're basically going to do ourselves, is do a token line item at some point.
Right. Oh, so, but I guess how... Right. So how token is token, I would say?
Well... You know, I said 20,000, 25,000. We haven't, as a town ourselves, haven't been able to figure out how we're going to cover even a third of the obligation. So we were thinking of a token amount as well. But
when is this when is this future obligation coming down? Do we know?
Nobody is clear on it. It could be next year. It could be 5 years from now.
So is part of this, just to sort of help me understand, is part of this trying to set up a reserve fund of these monies?
Yes.
Yes, it just sits there.
Okay. Because the liability is so... Okay.
Yeah, but maybe for clarification's sake, because I'm not sure the vast majority of the people sitting here tonight know what we're talking about.
Correct.
When we're talking about OPEB. So what we're talking about are unfunded retirement or pension payments that the town is obligated for in the future. There's no cash reserve in the town to pay them, so when the Piper comes calling 4, 5, or 6 years from now for hundreds of thousands of dollars, we don't have provision to take care of that obligation. So we're trying to, Carolyn's alluding to the fact that they're trying now to establish the start of a fund that can be built up over the next 5 to 10 years so that we will have cash available to meet this obligation that's coming down the pike.
But isn't this an ongoing obligation that we have all the time anyway?
No, there's a lot more baby boomers.
No, I understand that. It's an actuarial problem.
Correct.
We're funding plenty of people who retired who are on pensions already, and we're just worried about the graph going.
The mass amount that are going to retire at a specific time is just a huge, it's an unfunded.
It's an accelerating obligation.
It's an accelerated obligation, right?
So can I explain my understanding? When we met with the finance committee last year, and I know, Skip, that you weren't the chair last year, but this conversation came up, that the OPEB was going to be like our current current insurance benefits, that the town, it doesn't flow through the school, but when I do the end of the year report, I report that the town has supported the school with the retirement, with the insurance costs, and the Franklin County retirement gets reported on the end of the year report to the state that the town has given funds. So I'm a little bit confused. If we had a line item in here for $25,000, that you would give me the $25,000 for the line item, and then you would send me a bill and I'd send you a check back for the same $25,000. So if we're saying is it a cash transaction or just a reporting requirement that you want reflected to the state that the town is supporting that cost for the school.
Can I just suggest that, I don't know if this is the
time to figure that out for sure and put people on the spot about it, since it seems like such an unknown thing.
We could discuss it next Tuesday.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
On the 7th.
So it seems like something that needs to get worked out, and then in future years it's going to be, sounds like a percentage probably at some point of money that needs to be put aside. So, fair to say? Is that all right?
That's good.
I don't want to debate it.
Yeah. Something has to be built in for the budget.
I hear you.
It cannot be a town obligation.
Yeah. Hand way in the back.
Did I hear you say that the computer teacher was going from 4 days to one?
No.
I misheard that.
No, 80%.
5 days to four.
5 days to four.
Yes.
Okay. Down one day.
Excuse me?
Sounds like down one day.
Down one day, but it is open for children on the fifth day, on the day where there isn't a staffer there.
Teachers can sign their classes up to for open periods, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Anyone else? Questions? No? Okay. Well, in that case, we're going to close the public hearing and move on with our regular session. So I want to thank you, town's officials, for coming and listening. And certainly, everyone else, you're welcome to stay here and listen to us continue to deliberate. But if there's no more questions, public here, I'm going to move on. Superintendent, would you like to say one more thing?
Yes. Again, thank you all for coming. I really am pleased to see everyone here. I appreciate it, and I'm very, very happy to see you here. Please come to the town meeting in April. Please come to support the budget to help us continue what we're trying to do here at Deerfield with your support. Again, I wanted to thank you all for coming.
Hi, I'm Linda Gavin. I'm one of the senior planning consultants at the building. I know we sent you guys a letter about our just letting you know what our roles were in the school and that we were really excited about there being a reduction in the speech language pathologist position. And I just want to reiterate, you know, what Dr. Carey said about the severity of the kids that are coming in. Yes, have social, emotional, and behavior issues, but a lot of those children have significant communication disabilities. And by cutting the speech pathologist position will somewhere impact the service delivery to those children. So. Wanted to reiterate that and make sure you guys got our letter. And thank you.
Okay, so going on to our minutes from our last meeting. Anybody have any edits or comments or anything about those? Okay, second. Okay, any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thank you. Patty, financial statements? Do you want to give us a little rundown of
Sure, I did email you a copy of the statements. And there are 7 warrants for your signature tonight that total $94,958.92. Right now, our lines seem to be in balance, and I'm not concerned with overspending. Some lines look like they're overspent, but if we look at again the entire bucket, we're in good shape. And Janine's doing a great job overseeing her budget this year.
Anybody have any questions? So we are now on to our unfinished business and discussion and vote on our proposed FY18 budget. So, anybody have any questions?
about that. There's another provision in our agenda for a public comment. I suppose there's any public comments that you didn't make that maybe on some other topics. This would be a time to.
Yes, thank you.
There is, sorry.
There was something.
I beg your pardon.
Preschool. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
And so I've been thinking a lot about some of what's been happening kind of in our larger culture in our country in terms of increased deportations of immigrant students, recent comments at the federal level about rollbacks for certain protections for transgender students. And so I'm disturbed by that. I know we all probably have different political views, but I'm just wondering, as community and school leaders, what your thoughts are about how we can really protect some of the most vulnerable students in the community. And I've also been thinking about what my role could be as a parent in thinking about that and talking with other parents and educators. So I would just love it if you had some thoughts about that.
Direct you to my superintendent's message that is on the page, the Frontier Regional page, superintendent, my superintendent's message from the month of February, where I spoke to this very issue of the immigrant status and how right now we are following Department of Education, Department of Justice. This is what we're following, those mandates where, and we have McKinney-Vento laws that any child that is residing anywhere within our school districts comes to school, regardless of their immigrant status. And we will continue to keep our doors open for all students who live within our district to come to our schools. This is definitely something that is starting to alarm the bigger cities. I know Northampton is taking the stand through our collaborative in Northampton that we all belong to, Fairfield County and Hampshire County. They've really worked on it. I have reiterated a statement by the superintendent of Amherst, who also, they have quite a diverse population there, where they're reassuring their families. Our school district in Sunderland, we have a very diverse population, and the mention of any form of that kind of educational discrimination is not something that we are going to allow in this district. We will follow the laws, we will be very, very careful about that, but right now it's not impacting what our practice is and what our philosophy is.
I do. I fully support what she says. I fully support what you say. We won't tolerate any of that here. Our children should have every right to use any bathroom they choose. I would be there to protect them any way they needed. So I'm just so thankful we live in Massachusetts and in Deerfield. So we'll be here for them and any protection they need.
If I could just add, you specifically mentioned, I think, transgender issues as well, and maybe you already know this, but those issues are alive and well in our school system already, and I think that those folks and those families and those children feel supported, and it's really, probably because they haven't heard about it, is a good indication, maybe you do know, I'm not suggesting otherwise, but that it is supported, and it's, you know, for a lot of the kids, it's kind of, just is what it is. They're so much further ahead of the general population. The administration, it's already happening in our district, our little district. It is.
I was just thinking maybe it would be helpful to coordinate our messaging and making sure that people are aware that they should feel safe in our community and accepted for whatever. And maybe it would be helpful. And Trevor could probably spearhead this and make sure our messaging is correct and messaging is out there publicly and it's consistent.
I think that just to
second that. I think that would be a great idea, because I'm glad, and I will go to your page and read it, but I think when it's directly sent to families, it's just a little more accessible.
Well, I mean, we could just do a more public explanation about it, or something. I mean, we can figure out some way to do it that it's not, people do not feel at all that we're, you know, it's pointed to them, but it's just that we are a safe community.
Yeah.
We are accepting of everything and whatever. I mean, I think it's just horrible what's happening. So whatever we can do to reinforce people feeling safe is really important.
Yeah, I just wanted to add, Megan, one other piece, and I agree with what you said, David, the fact that people have not heard about it, that's a positive thing, and we've had a lot of wonderful feedback from families regarding the transgender issue, to the point where I recently was contacted by Rutgers University and will be participating in a research study that they're doing on how schools are handling the transgender issue and making sure students feel safe. So that's something that's coming up in the next couple of weeks. So I felt good about that, because it speaks to our school and what our teachers are doing here to make all students feel welcome. So that's just something else I wanted to share with everybody.
But I think if you do outreach to us as general government, then it would be so much more helpful, because we want to be consistent, but we also want to say the right thing and make sure that it is effective. So, you know, working together, we should work together on this.
Yeah, great. Okay, so back to our budget discussions. Anybody have any further questions or comments about the budget, or before we move forward and discuss?
I just want to thank the administration for their hard work on the budget, and for Jeanine for working as hard as you could. You know, everyone at the school to take the sacrifices that need to be made to level out this dip in funding in the next couple of years. And make a motion to approve the budget.
Or
recommend the budget.
I will second that motion.
Any further discussion about that?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I can't commend Catherine Rashad and Janet Ryan enough for their hard work and their creativity for the event. This year, the theme was a little bit different. I shared with you earlier that it was about birds, and it just was amazing the direction that the teachers took the theme. We had Henry Lappin, who came in, and he talked about various bird beaks. He kind of acted out some birds. It was a really unique performance that he did for the students, and he designed his own bird masks that kind of replicated the different beaks between pelicans and the crane, the hummingbird, a heron, that sort of thing. The Neels performed. They performed here for us before, and they're a popular group local. They perform at the Iron Horse quite often in Northampton, so it's nice to have some celebrities in the building. And Janet Ryan led, of course, each of our grades doing a separate performance on stage in the morning. And one thing I do want to point out that I was impressed with, as well as many other teachers who commented in the hallway, Catherine Machado, our teacher, she's incredibly creative, but this year she designed a video. So when the students were rotating around the classrooms and they went to the art room, she actually made a YouTube video of the story of the Phoenix. And what was really amazing about it was that it was, I walked in before it started, and I heard this voice, and it was wonderful narrative voice, and it was someone you saw a hand painting this, kind of in fast motion, this beautiful piece of artwork, and it's in the building, you can see. And it was Catherine narrating while she was painting and kind of going through a time lapse. And it was really impressive to see something that you would, so professionally done. So I think about the talented staff that we have here, and I just want to acknowledge that. So I want to thank everyone for their efforts. The 100th day of school, I thought we'd never reach it with all the snow days. And we did. February 16th was the 100th day of school. And I'd like to commend kindergarten. The students are always engaged in a lot of really fun activities. Bringing in their 100, what do you call them? Their collections. 100 collections of things that they choose. A lot of them bring in cereal or beads or whatnot. And then this year, the students kind of were little engineers in designing geometric shapes of marshmallows that are also displayed in the hallway, so they had a lot of fun. Of course, my favorite always is the self-portrait of what you would look like when you're 100 years old. That's really interesting. And I also wanted to talk about something interesting in fifth grade. I happened to walk into, it was Kayla's Kennedy classroom, actually, and Gretchen Law, our reading teacher, was in there, and they had been working on students doing research projects, and they were just in the early stages of picking a topic. Everything was so differentiated and self-selected. Students chose a topic of their interest, of their own choice, but this particular lesson that I was observing, they had the students, they were talking about how to plan and prepare a presentation when they got to the point of the end of the research project. And in order to have them plan their presentation, they went through an exercise. I don't know if anyone has done the Myers-Briggs. It's kind of like to see what your strengths are, the multiple intelligence sort of thing. Myers-Briggs is more for the adults. This is a child-friendly version. Cool. And it had students, and they made it in child-friendly language where if they're music smart, picture smart, word smart, nature smart, and so on. And the students were so incredibly engaged and really trying to see and to learn about themselves and what surprised them, what came up, and what was something that didn't surprise them. They kind of figured, I know I'm nature smart or I'm body smart and that sort of thing. And using the results of that to kind of steer them in the direction of choosing how they would present. So I'm looking forward to seeing this go through to the end, but it was really an excellent example of differentiation and student choice. So that was something I just wanted to share with everyone. And then finally, I mentioned the last school committee meeting that I was going to announce our Grinspoon Award winner for Deerfield, and that is Denise Stanak, if you haven't heard already. Incredibly deserving. Incredibly deserving. Always a mentor for not only pre-service teachers, but her own colleagues. I go to her for different things as well, just for points of view and how to approach, whether it's reading a parent letter or that sort of thing. And I'm excited for both her and Sue Scott. So that dinner's coming up in April.
April 27th?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm just getting the details. I was gonna put that.
Okay, so I can turn it over to you. But we're very proud of both of us.
Very
good. As we are everybody, so it's been, an interesting month of school, past month with all the snowstorms, but you can see all the wonderful things that are happening despite that, the interruptions.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so ricocheting over here.
Yes, thank you. So Denise Danick is our winner of this year of the Grinspoon Award. The Pioneer Valley Excellence in Teaching Distinguished Educator Award. And as part of that award, there is a dinner on April 27th at the Log Cabin with other Franklin and I think it's Hampshire County winners. The price is $250 plus an extra $250 for those educators who submit a classroom project idea.
Cool.
So I don't know, you know, we'll find out. And they also get a 3 month, a kind of a 3 month visa to go to the YMCA or the Springfield Jewish Community Center.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
And they get tuition grants for grad courses. So we're really just excited. It's a wonderful thing to be included in, and I'm very happy too. I'm happy for Denise, and I'm happy for Deerfield.
Yeah,
so that's great. I just wanted to reiterate too, today the principals had a wonderful morning of excitement and practicing on the computers. They took the test, the MCAS prep program, and that was a blast. I'm sure Louise Law, our curriculum coordinator, our district technology, Maureen Belchek, and she is our technology teacher, and they really schooled the principals in what they need to know, and now, of course, it's going to have to trickle down. It's a big undertaking. It's going to be, you know, definitely a paradigm shift for everyone, but I think in the end it'll be okay. And we did talk a little bit. We're planning to have our calendar ready for the April joint school committee's meeting, and we had a wonderful in my instructional meeting, and we're talking about next year's PD, which I think is going to be wonderful. I'm really excited for what we're doing, and for what Louise and Sarah Mitchell, Louise Law, Kim McCarthy have come up with. And one of the things they stressed is, and not so much, you know, new initiatives. Let's buckle down, you know, double down on what we've done, and give the teachers more time together. Yeah. And so we're pretty excited about what we're going to be bringing forward.
Great.
Thank you.
Is there a feedback loop from the teachers on professional development, how it went, and what they're looking for, and what they're looking for?
May I ask Louise to speak to that? She's in the back.
Sure.
Louise?
Me?
The question.
Sorry.
Is there a feedback?
Yeah, the question is there a feedback loop?
Yeah, we do survey teachers. We have a team of grade level leaders also that are teachers that represent each grade level, and they get feedback from colleagues, come back, and we talk about what's going well, what do teachers need. One of the big shifts next year will be moving to grade book Empower School for report cards, and we're planning to give teachers lots of time during those early release times to really get consistent about how they're entering data into that program so that we can have calibration among all of our teachers. In other words, what one teacher thinks of as mastery is going to be the same as what another teacher thinks of as mastery, and what evidence we're going to use. So that's going to be a big focus next year, is getting teachers comfortable with using that system, because that is a big shift. So instead of introducing new curriculum shifts, we're going to be working on how do we assess, how do we report, what data is most important for us to measure student growth. So that's going to be a big focus for next year. So I'm meeting with grade level leaders next week to get their input, and then they get input from their colleagues to give back to us. So it's a constant conversation.
Okay. Well said. Thank you. You certainly can, yeah.
I just wanted to report back on the efforts of the Capital Planning Committee from the town of Deerfield, in which I serve as a representative for the school committee. The Capital Planning Committee did review the three projects proposed from the administration, and they have been approved. It's like in different levels than they were submitted at, but we just moved the money around to reflect the support that Patty had sent along with the recommendations. But coming out of our meetings, once we had finished with this year's proposals from throughout the town and the school, we've now begun to focus in on a long-range extended plan, and our chair has generated a list based on the school's depreciation logs, and there is a school component piece of which I will get a copy, or we will get a copy to the administration to start reviewing and thinking in terms of long-term replacement for the, not just the items on the list, but other things that may be looming on the horizon. And this is a long-range horizon from not 5 years, 10 years, but 15, 25 years out. So that's just an update on where that committee stands and the work that's going on in that.
Just a point of clarification, when you say they're approved to go forward on the town warrant,
yes,
correct? They're
correct.
Not approved to
no, right. They're approved to go forward on the warrant.
Okay.
Yes. I'm sorry.
I don't want to spend the
to
money.
To be recommended to the warrant. No, don't spend the money yet.
Right. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And any report from the collaborative?
No report.
No report? Okay.
Yet, right?
All right.
This is standard.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to move that we go into executive session pursuant to appropriate law to discuss strategy with respect to litigation. I think it'll have a detrimental effect on our position if we do this in public. So, and I'm also going to say that we are not going to reconvene in open session, so there won't be any more
well, we reconvene.
Business.
We reconvene to adjourn.
We can be
really not conducting.
Well, we don't know. Right. Well, or we. Okay. Yeah. But meaning, you're not going to miss anything because we're not reconvening for open session.
So thank you all for coming tonight.
Yeah.
Thank you.
See you tomorrow.
Yes, exactly.